No, I mean, I would stay away from suing lawyers, because at the end of the day, we can fight them longer. They can fight you longer than you can fight them. My sense would be that there is some sort of, you know, professional responsibility that they would stand behind in their work, but there was also probably no warranty that they're giving you with, you know, their engagement, okay? I, you know, never had that situation. Stephen, you had a...
Yeah, before you erase that, I was going to say, schedule is a huge driver that's kind of made up of a lot of those components, like
so,
environmental.
Yeah. So the whole process related to any entitlement or any of work, and especially, we've said this before, a lot of times when you're in this environment, you're going to try to tie up the land without going hard. So what's the time frame in order to get to a point so you can structure the contract in a way that you're able to obtain the changes that you're looking for, the entitlements that you're looking for, and not have to be at risk, right? Because at the end of the day, what you don't want to do is plug a bunch of money down, right? Guaranteed, pay $250 million thinking I'm going to get a casino, and now they don't have a casino. And there was no, you know, sort of timeline on that. So now, maybe they don't need the $250 million, you know. Maybe they could still get their entitlements in time, you know. But definitely, Stephen, time, the time involved in a process is critical. Okay? Thoughts, questions? So, he went through several examples, and these are real-life examples that I can't talk to the particulars, but the first one, they bought an apartment building, and they ran into there was fraud. So ultimately, the guy who represented himself to be the seller did not have the authority or the capacity to sell that site. I don't remember the particulars, that there was an estate issue, if there was a divorce, if there was a corporate, you know, fight. But ultimately, they had to backstop or, you know, wind up being supported by title because it was fraud. But nobody really took the time to find out if the party that was representing to be the owner really had the rights to convey title. It seems basic. And that's one that hopefully we've got a reputable title company that'll stand behind that. So, you know, part of their chain of title review is understanding who the seller is and making sure that that person really does have capacity. These things happen all the time. My nephew bought his house sometime last summer. And I don't remember exactly, at this point I don't remember what the issue was, but so he's selling the house, and so this guy's selling it. Pepe, I don't know, you know, some guy, all right? So Pepe, and Pepe represented himself as the owner of the house, and he was an attorney, and he'd gotten divorced, and so he just bought a little house and fixed it up, and 1 year later he's flipping it to my nephew. So it's all good, you know, my brother and my sister-in-law are basically giving him the money to buy this thing. He's ready to go to closing. 2 or 3 days before the closing, they got some Mickey Mouse title company doing this thing. But they pick up on the fact that the contract was signed by Pepe, but then when they start looking at the deed that's being conveyed, it's being signed by, no, it was like Margarita and Maria, two other people. So wait a minute. First of all, you know, you've got a sales contract here with one guy, and he goes, "No, the problem is that I don't really own the house. This is like for my daughters." So, you know, my sister-in-law does a lot of forensic accounting work. She's a CPA as well. So she ran all over. So all of a sudden, turned out like this: Margarita and Maria didn't really live at the addresses where they were supposed to be. They weren't related to this guy. You know. Anyway, it wound up being. And then the title company said, "Okay, we're not providing title on this." So that's when my sister-in-law called me, and I said, "No title, no closing," you know, because she was like, "Well, but the attorney, no title policy, no closing. I don't care. It was a $200,000 house. I mean, it's a little dollhouse, you know, but no title policy, no closing." And eventually, he wound up closing on it like 6-7 weeks later, and eventually. So, because then he said, "Well, I haven't really conveyed the title yet, but I'm going to convey the title now." And so he went through this whole convoluted thing where he eventually conveyed the title to people, and the title company got comfortable with providing an insurance policy on So if you've got it and you're comfortable with the company, then go on ahead and, you know, do the closing. But, you know, typical everyday transaction where, you know, people are, there's shenanigans going on, you know? And you don't know, at the end of the day, I couldn't figure out what was going on, who he was trying to hide the money from, you know? So, well, probably Bebita, you know?
We run into that all the time, leasing, you know, hundreds of landowners in a project. We'll have a landowner that wants to sign a deal with us, and then we go look at the deed, and his wife is on there, but he doesn't want his wife to know about this thing and get money from it, or there's an estranged child that somehow has a land contract.
And you run into older people that are either incapacitated, you know, they don't have all their faculties. You've got children that are manipulating. The situation that Jesse had, if I remember correctly, was they entered into a contract with an individual who did not own the asset, but he had a contract to buy it. And that's very common in real estate, where a lot of people want to play that flip game. Yeah. So
and there is a check thing, there is a little box that you check, and if somebody, you know, like, is not your...
Where do you check the box?
I mean, there is a little thing that you...
What purchase agreement? We're dealing with commercial transactions here that don't have forms.
I'm saying in this case we're at home.
Well, but this was with my nephew.
Yeah.
But some people may sign a little box, but el papel lo aguanta todo. The paper holds everything, you know? I mean, you can put anything on paper, you know, at the end of the day. But what's very common in real estate, and maybe you haven't seen, but what has been common over time is people lock up a deal and then try to flip it before they, and you may see that with land a lot, you know, especially you're trying to piece together, you know, a large parcel, somebody gets a, you know, hold of it or wind of what's going on, then they start trying to front run you to get to all the adjoining neighbors, right? And they don't really have rights. So they're either representing that they have rights, or are not representing the true rights that they have. Well, yeah, I own it. No, you don't own it. You have a contract to own it, because what they want is then get the contract from you to simultaneously close. So, and some were not, they got burned. Are sales proceeds sufficient to pay off all liens? Okay, so the whole sort of lien search process is very important, okay? Okay, so he talked about another one here. They enter into a joint venture where they thought that they wanted to get into the campground business. So, you know, we talked about, I think in the capital markets class, I mean, from funeral homes to, you know, real estate is a parking lots, whatever. Real estate is a lot, right? So campgrounds, you can kind of think it's kind of like self-storage facility too. It's a real estate business. And so you buy a plot of land, you put some utilities out there, and then people come and pitch a tent or park a trailer, and it's a rental business, right? It's like a hotel. It's a limited, really limited service hotel. So they wanted to go into this business. They wanted to learn a little bit. They knew a guy. One of the guys in the company knew a guy that owned several of these. So they went to talk to the guy. The guy says, yeah, sure, whatever. So they gave him like $10 million to go buy a bunch of campgrounds. They never did diligence on their partner. And they're a joint venture partner with this guy. And so they put the money into the company. Turns out the guy's a bad guy. State Attorney General gets involved. They wind up losing all of their lots. They get confiscated by the state. They got done all kinds of stuff. And now they don't even own the fee. They owned a company that owned all this stuff, and they lost it. And why? They didn't do diligence on their partners, right? So, you know, we've talked about in real estate a lot of times, we're focused on asset level diligence, but if we're doing an entity level transaction and we're buying a company that owns real estate and we're investing in a company that owns real estate and we're investing in a company that owns multiple assets, We need to do entity level diligence. So we need to do diligence on the entity. What is their tax structure? What are their legal obligations? You know, what liabilities might they have? And to the extent that we're going to stay in bed, we're going to stay in partners with people, we've got to do diligence on the people. We actually got to take a look at the personal. And that's one of the things is investigate who you're dealing business with. Know who you're doing. There's no good business with bad people. Okay? So. Another one that he writes here is failing to act on red flags. I want to just tell you a personal one that has nothing to do with real estate, but when we want something, I said the other day, I had a boss that never found a deal that he didn't like. All right, so you get enamored with stuff, right? So you get enamored and you want it. So at the end of every football season, as I said, you know, there's Bernice at Jackson, right? There's always a change, you know. You're not happy with a coach, say, you know, you let go, you don't renew them for the next year, or, you know, life conditions. Nowadays in high school, you know, high school sports in general, a lot of people do this as a part-time thing, really for the love of the game, but life conditions change, you know. Kids get older, you get busier at work, whatever. So every year you got to look for new coaches. So our head coach came across a couple of guys, two brothers from Jackson who had been dismissed, who said they wanted to come coach with us at school at LaSalle. So he met with them, he liked them, and he said to them, okay, great, let me talk to the AD, we'll set up a meeting next week. Sets up a meeting, AD's great, texts the guys, doesn't hear from them. A month goes by. So I said to him the other day, Matt, did you ever hear about, you know, back from these guys? Funny you say that. He goes, they called me out of the blue yesterday. And they want to come and interview. I said, Matt, I know you don't want to hear this because you're like, you like the guys, but if somebody disappears for a month, how reliable are they going to be? No, I hear you, but, you know, I really like them. I think they could be really good with the kids. I go, dude, that's already a bad sign. So he sets up a meeting with the AD. They didn't show up.
Of course
they didn't show up. So, but the point is a lot of times along the way, we have red flags, but we don't want to see them, right? You know, that girl's no good for you. We've heard that one before, right? Your friends tell you, your friends stop hanging around with you, you know?
She good to me, though.
You know?
good.
Okay, anyway. Read the writing on the wall, okay, a lot of times. They don't always tell the sellers don't always tell the truth, okay? So they buy a triple net lease. There's a Staples store on it, right? So, you know, the guy, as I said, people can say whatever, but in most real estate transactions, you are likely not going to get any sort of representation from a seller, you know, in a contract. So at the end of the day, buyer beware, you're the guy that's got to do diligence, right? So, you know, they get, you know, they go, they do their investigation, they do a, you know, very cursory thing, and they're focused on cash flow. So they're focused on what's Staples credit look like, you know, and they pretty much just sort of bank it. They do a very light diligence on that. I think it was a 1031, they need to flip, they buy this thing. So buy it quick, post acquisition, it starts raining, heavy rains, flooding in the street, moisture starts coming up from the floor. So, you know, they study, there's not a proper barrier underneath, right?
Okay.
They never really did a true structural review. They weren't really focused on what could happen. They're focused on the cash flow and all those stuff. And they're thinking triple net lease, right? So these triple net leases for the, you know, CVS's and Walgreens, they're typically responsible for everything. But the structural issues are always on the owner.
Yep. Mm-hmm.
So at the end of the day, what happened? They got stuck with, you know, store had to be vacated, you know, bit by bit. They had to redo all of the foundations and seal everything. End of the day, yield was not what they expected it to be. Okay, so
yeah.
make sure that you either So he's picked, I'm surprised, he's a very sort of very conservative guy. He writes a little thing with a kid shooting a bird to somebody going, liar, liar, pants on fire. So try to get disclosures, try to get representations on disclosures, try to get holdbacks on contracts, but that's not going to happen most of the time. Do your diligence. Do your diligence. Think about all of the things that could potentially go wrong and try to address them so that you can mitigate the risk.
So when they had to vacate the premises for the structural damage, that meant that there was no, they didn't have to pay their lease?
Well, right. So what's happened, I had a similar situation when I became the CFO at Kadena. We used to have a division that used to do build-to-suit for sales for small businesses. And for some reason, we started getting, so they were industrial buildings typically, we started getting concrete cracking. And, you know, so there was this whole back and forth on whether we really tested the concrete. Then the project manager said it was raining that day, and the, you know, the guy said we shouldn't pour, but the development guys poured anyway. Wound up, at the end of the day, after months back and forth, their business had to stop. We had to come in, and redo the floor. And they had a business interruption issue. And we wound up having to pay for it. In a situation like a lease, like with Staples, you'd have to take a look at what the lease says. But likely, if they're unable to occupy the space, they're not going to pay rent. And there's probably going to have to be a goodwill issue associated with the fact that they've got to move things out, there's employees they gotta pay, then you're probably gonna be on hook for that stuff. So there's a whole issue of what does a contract say in relation to costs and incidental damages or incidental costs associated with a loss. It depends on what the lease says.
But so business interruption insurance.
So the question becomes, based on the contract, whose policy's at risk here? Who's got the risk of loss here, right? And if I'm a real estate developer, I don't have business interruption insurance for Staples. They may have insurance, and they may be able to go to it, but they may also have a contract with me that says I'm responsible for that. Another one. They buy a golf course community with a bunch of, you know, development rights, but they had already exceeded the development rights of the balance of the property. And so they paid so much per door to develop, but they couldn't physically develop there. So I had to wind up buying additional land in an adjacent parcel in order to accommodate the development rights that they underwrote, that they paid for. So again, this goes back to understanding the entitlements. Understand what you're paying for, understand what you could physically build, and understand what you are regulatorily or under regulation able to build. Okay? A lot of times development orders will give you more capacity than what you can actually physically fit on a particular site. So, you know, you may say, okay, I build 1 million square feet of retail, 2,000 multifamily units, so many single family units, and so much office. But when you actually break the block down, depending on, say, how much retail you do, you may not be able to build all the office that you're entitled for because you can't provide the parking. Or you can only provide the parking and you do structured parking and you didn't underwrite structured parking. So does that make sense? So we need to, bless you again. We got a lot of sneezing going on. I'll skip that one. That's a little bit too much convoluted. Background. They bought a 1,500-acre farm with lakes and streams. You know, they did all their flood studies and all that, but guess what? Record rainfalls, lakes overflow, a dam broke upstream, flooded everything. You know, they were wiped out, couldn't build there for, you know, how many number of years. Stuff happens sometimes that you can't control, so just, you know what your risks are. The last one I'm going to cover is, he talks about the difference between knowing the difference between political and ministerial approvals, right? So what he calls ministerial approvals are rights that you have that you basically have to stop at all of the doors, right? Okay, I got the fire department, I got, you know, the electrical inspector, you know, I got, you know, whatever, the fire guy. You've got rights. All you got to do is go through the steps. As opposed to political approvals, I now have to go in front of an elected body and get the right or the approval to develop what I need to, you know, to get done. And there's a much bigger uncertainty with political approvals than with ministerial approvals, right? So under ministerial ones, in theory, you've got the right to do it if you go through all the steps, right? Money say about you can do all the things that the law says you can do it and nobody needs to vote for it. You just need to please the person behind the desk, which can be cumbersome, but you should ultimately get there. The other one is you actually have to stand in front of a hearing and say, I'd like to convert this use to this. I'd like to change the master plan from this to that. I'd like to change the urban development boundary from here to there. You know, I would like to increase the density. I would like to increase the height. And you may not have the...
Some cases you have a combination of them too.
You may have a combination.
Yeah, you have the all the rights and you still have to stand in front of a hearing and they can ask for whatever they want and you have to go back and forth until you get it. It's a pain.
Yeah, no. Listen, the last one that I'm going to... talk about it, and this one, it doesn't seem like that, but I've heard these in the past. States get pushed for money, and all of a sudden, they just have these unrealistic fees that they'll impose on commercial transactions. So he talked about both in Texas and Virginia, they all of a sudden, from when they actually contracted a deal to when they closed, to record a deed, to record the mortgage, to execute the note, the costs like quintupled, you know, and so that may not break a deal, but it may add a couple $100,000 to your transaction out of the blue because royalty income didn't come in and you got to pay for, you know, what's the name of the running back at LSU?
Fournette.
That guy, you got to pay for, you know, he's got to graduate so he can go to the, you know, to the big league. So anyway.
He doesn't have to graduate, he's got to make the sophomore.
He just has to make, okay. You don't have to graduate anymore, right?
No. You go pro.
So you're not really, like a student anymore. You're not a student athlete. You're just an athlete, right? So everything we tell the kids about, like, all we tell the kids about, you got to stay in school. It's all about school. It doesn't really count.
Okay. You're really good to leave.
I'm sorry.
It'd be really good to jump out of college early.
I always threaten to cut these things out, and I don't, but, and that's to show kids, so I'm just going to pick any sport you want, okay? You pick soccer. Pick youth soccer, for instance, in America. There's like 9 million youth soccer players in America. There are something like 2 million kids playing high school soccer in America. So if you already, once you get to high school, all of a sudden numbers come way down, right? I forget the exact number, but there's like 200 universities that play D1 soccer. There'll be another couple hundred that play D2. Everything else is financial aid, you know, financial, not scholarship. So each of those schools can give 9 scholarships out. So you've got, say, 400 times 9 is what? Is that 3,600 scholarships?
Yeah, 3,600.
3,600 scholarships. And they typically split those. Let's say split them in half. So let's say that there's now 7,000 soccer players that have a scholarship in college. And then let's assume that an American player can only aspire to play in the MLS. And let's assume that in the MLS, you know, there's only half the players are American. But let's assume they're all American, right? Every team's going to carry 20 guys. Let's say there's 20 teams, right? So there's 4,000 guys. So if you're the 8-year-old kid, right, that thinks he's going to be a professional star, what are the chances? And you could do the same math for baseball. You could do the same math for basketball.
That if you have more of a chance to make the NBA roster right now at any age than you do play on the PGA Tour, there's only 200 spots on the PGA Tour. You have more of a chance to pick up basketball at like 20 years old.
It's not going to happen. Listen, I. So two days ago, I see we have a kid that's graduating. He's 6'5", good basketball player. Puerto Rico is like, you know, it's like not a state or whatever. It's kind of an A. So they compete internationally as a nation. So he's on the Puerto Rican national U-17 team. And there's good basketball players out of Puerto Rico. So what I'm saying is, he's a kid of good caliber. So I see him Thursday. Jesus, what are you going to do? He goes, he's like all bummed out. He goes, I've only got one offer. It's at St. Thomas University, an NAIA school in Miami. I said, that's great. He's like, no, you know, he's like all bummed out. I really wanted more. And I'm like, dude, you know what? It's the same number. How many millions of kids play basketball? How many play high school basketball? Look, just thank God you've got an opportunity. Your parents can't pay for college, but you can go to college. Yeah, but I wanted more. Yeah, you know, dude, we all want more, you know? You know, but, you know, it's very tough to, that's why you tell the kids, you know, academically, man, you gotta study. It's not about, like, Nike and, you know, all this money and all that stuff. So, anyway, I want to change, for the next 30 minutes, I want to change topics altogether. And I want to talk about closings. So, we buy something, we do diligence, and we ultimately come to a closing. So, in the residential realm, it's all very simple, right? So there's like, sort of like state mandated or federally mandated, there's form contracts that, you know, realtors have. But above all else, when you get to closing, to protect buyers, there are requirements that, for example, require you to use a specific closing form. What do we call that form? HUD-1, I think it's the one.
Yeah,
okay.
Yeah.
So there's a formal form, and then there's, in advance of that, you've got to give the buyer an estimate of what all the costs are going to be. And so that's all great for residential transactions, but we're not talking about residential real estate here in this firm. We're talking about commercial real estate. And for commercial real estate, it's a wide open game. There are no forms. There are no form contracts. So every contract is negotiated between a buyer and a seller. All conditions are negotiated between a buyer and a seller. There are common practices that may prevail. You might be in certain areas where, for example, it may be customary for a seller to pay a title policy endorsement because it's cheaper for him to pay for an endorsement and to give you a deed with title insurance. But in other places, it may not be. It may be customary in certain places that prorations, you know, are done, you know, through, you know, that the day of the closing is the buyer's. And in other places, the day of the closing is the seller's. Okay? So you can agree on that, or you can go by local customs. But there is no form, there's no federal guideline that addresses how you, one, transact the rights and obligations and the conditions related to that. And there is no document that says, this is how you're going to settle all this. This is how you're going to summarize this closing. Now, in the accounting class, we talk about how accountants define closings, right? Closings are, you know, where several conditions precedent to a sale actually happen, right? Where the rights and the duties of the buyer and seller have been exchanged, consideration has been exchanged. You don't need to memorize these things, but the closing is kind of a place or a time or a condition or a situation in which buyer and seller and all of the parties that are related to a transaction come together and in which funds are exchanged. And hopefully all of the conditions and all of the promises and all of the rights and obligations are also exchanged. I'm old enough to remember that in commercial transactions you would actually go to an attorney's office similar to a residential transaction. And you have all kinds of stuff going on, and papers coming in and out, and stuff being faxed, and that's all done sort of virtually now. And in fact, in most large commercial transactions, your title company will serve as a closing agent, very similar to what happens in residential transactions. So there's a couple of large firms out there that are publicly traded, First American, Chicago Title, there's another one called Lawyers Title. There's three or four large title companies out there that are recognized that will not only provide the insurance, but they'll also handle your closing. Now, they won't handle your purchase sale agreement. That's something that with your attorney and a buyer or the seller, whatever the counterparty, you're going to negotiate, okay? And so through your attorney or directly, you're going to be providing to the title company a series of, you know, documents or information in order to get the closing done. I'm going to show you a commercial closing from a...
Isn't there a compelling need to standardize and streamline that process?
Maybe we live in a centrist state, but since we're libertarians, no. No, the answer is as much as I'm saying that it's all fair game, there is no need to standardize because as sophisticated business people, we should be able to negotiate anything that's within the law. And the closing process is not stipulated, but there is a standard practice. And, you know, there is a form that First American would work from. There is a form that Chicago Title will work from. And I'll show you what one of these look like. So they don't need to look identical like in resin. You don't need to protect commercial, institutional, sophisticated buyers and sellers the way, theoretically, the government should, you know, should represent or should protect individuals. Yes, sir.
Is there, you know, for these commercial loans, is there like a governing body?
I didn't say loans. I said closing.
Yeah, closing. Is there like a governing body that has like maybe agreements? Like in construction, we have the AIA forms,
no,
right?
So
which get tailored instead of every time, you know, spending a ridiculous amount of money with lawyers going back and forth reviewing their contract language. I mean, it sounds inefficient.
Yeah. So there's two different things. As it relates to actual contracts, the answer is no. You know, if you use Greenberg Traurig, again, you use Holland and Knight, and forget, I got a better one. If you use whatever, you know, Greg Marks, or you use Izzy Alfonso, two partners at Greenberg Traurig, they may have separate form, you know, seller's agreements for. So every guy's going to have their thing. Hopefully within a firm, they're going to be pretty similar, okay? But every firm does their own thing. Every attorney does their own thing. As it relates to closings, I go back to, I'm going to show you a form from First American. There's three or four guys out there. They're close enough to one another, and there are definite conditions that one creates that you don't need to standardize it to the level. It's not like a construction contract where sort of AIA already takes into consideration what state law might be and sort of, you know, makes things easy between two different counterparties in a transaction.
So, Professor, question. So,
yes.
Everything starts with the buyer, they just submit an offer, and that's basically how everything starts, like whatever the contract might be. Because I know for residential, even though I know this is not, it have nothing to do with residential, there is an agreement with everything. There's just one specific form for when you're going to submit an offer, and that's how everything starts. So,
right.
For commercial, it's just the buyer just submit their draft of their agreement, and that's how everything starts.
Okay, so there's the answer to that is there's two or three different things that happen in practice. If you've got an institutional auction process going on, typically what's going to happen is at some point, the seller is going to provide a form contract that they're willing to sign,
yeah.
And they're going to ask you to give not only a price that you're offering, but also a markup version of that contract with what changes you want to make to that contract and what you're expecting from the seller. So what you're going to provide as reps and warranties as a buyer and what you're expecting the seller to provide. So part of their consideration is not only what you're paying, but what you're asking them to represent. Let's say that I sort of, you know, just go off market, I identify a guy, I want to buy something. Typically what we're going to say, you know, guy, I may come to you and put something in writing, very sort of, you know, going back to what we call it, you know, we talked about this earlier, it was a term sheet or an offer sheet, sort of outlining general conditions. Based on that, there may be further dialogue. that further dialogue may say, okay, buyer, your attorney draft a contract, you spend the money drafting, and I will then have my lawyer mark it up. Or you might say, okay, you know what, it is interesting enough, I'm going to draft the agreement and send it to you, okay, and then you mark it up. So
it could be.
It could be, yeah, but I mean, listen, the only situations where I'm going to see, you're typically somebody coming in already with a form contract, that I've seen, is, so if you're an acquisitions guy for Burger King or, you know, Steak and Shake or whatever, and you're buying hundreds of properties a year, you're not going to have, like, you've got in-house counsel, you've got a contract, which is what you want, and you're going to submit that contract, effect like a residential one, sort of as your offer. Here it is. But, you know, you're buying 1,500 acres somewhere, you know, you identified a farmer, you want to put together 5,000 acres and do a wind farm or something, you got to make them an offer first, probably have a dialogue first, before you start spending money on an attorney. Yes, Victor?
Can you talk about closing costs and what's consistent with a closing cost and who pays for it? Because I don't really know too much about that.
I'll talk about that right now.
So what you're previously talking about is like starting with an LOI or something?
You could call it an LOI.
There's the form I'm going to send you. Hold on. I'm definitely not going to send you the solution to the case.
Where?
You should.
Okay.
Are you
going to
send the form to us? I mean, not the solutions, but just about.
I'll tell you what I'm going to send you. Okay, so, Victor, everything is negotiated, okay? Depending on the locality in which you are, there may be some customs, okay? There may be, you know, and again, I gave you the example. In some places it may be that, so here's what I'm going to send you a little document with a little bit of a backdrop as with basic assumptions that you could walk into. I think basically you could walk into a transaction assuming that, barring having negotiated something specifically, whatever cost is going to be incurred is going to be incurred by the guy who is reaping the benefits of what that cost is. So as an example, I buy a property. I need to do a survey. I didn't negotiate with the seller for him to provide a survey. Right. I need the survey. Right. I'm going to pay for the survey. Right. Now, it may be that you're a seller. You just did a survey because you wanted to prep for the sale and you wanted to know what the heck was out there. That you may say to me, hey, you know what? I'm going to throw in the survey, or I'm going to throw in the update of the survey for you. And we'll negotiate that, and that will be in the contract. Okay? But I think the basic starting point is always going to be whoever's benefiting from the cost is the one who's going to have to pay for it. Okay. I'll give you another example. I'm a seller. I have an existing mortgage. I need to satisfy a mortgage. I'm going to have to incur some costs. You know, I'm going to have to pay somebody to do that. I may have some prepayment costs associated with it. You came and knocked on my door. My basic assumption is going to be whatever it cost me to satisfy that mortgage, other than the face value, I'm going to have to pay. I've got prepayment. I can either push it on you, but I think the assumption has to be whatever it costs to satisfy my mortgage is me. I'm a buyer. I'm going to finance it. I got to finance. I got to pay fees for a mortgage. I got to pay stamps to record a mortgage. I got to pay an attorney to negotiate all that. As the buyer, I'm going to have to get an appraisal. I'm going to have to provide that. Now, you talk about appraisals. Here's a common one. I'm going to sell. I'm an institutional seller. I know I'm going to go through a bid process. I go out and hire CBRE to appraise my building. Why? Because now I, not only do I have a value for my purposes, now I can go to the buyers, hey, you guys, we got to do this in 15 days. Guess what? Here's an appraisal from CBRE. For $1,500, they've agreed to update it for all you guys. You know, the work's done. They just got updated for the last 10 days and personalize it to you. Okay? Here it is. So, but everything's negotiated, Victor. Does that make sense?
Okay.
Now, in the absence of that negotiation, there's interpretation and there's going to be common practices. Okay? So, a contract is silent as to closing, right? I'm going to tell you my experience has been prorations at closing. My experience has been that the seller gets the prorations. He closes as of the end of that day, right? So he'll pick up all the prorated income and expenses through that day, and the buyer picks up the next day. It would also not be unreasonable that in certain places, the custom might be that the seller finishes prorating at midnight the day before, and the buyer, because he's buying that day, gets all the prorations. In most cases, not typically material. Okay? A lot of times people try to structure transactions at the end of the month to not have to prorate things to get into battles over this stuff, okay? But did I answer your question? So the answer is it depends.
Okay.
What about like title insurance? Depends who picks the title company. It's also, because even though residential we have, it could be, is negotiable too, but there are standards. So I don't know if there is standard.
I would tell you again, experience, I'm a buyer. I need title policy. I want to go get my own policy. I'm going to pay for it. I'm a seller. I have a policy in place that I can endorse. I can endorse it for a heck of a lot less money. I may entice the buyer to lower his closing cost by saying, listen, and you know what? I'll endorse the title policy, you know, because I'm standing behind this, okay? So that's just the way it is. In our case, what we used to do, and I think I've said this before, as a firm, we used to always get our own title independent of whatever the seller did. We wouldn't, you know, they had a surveyor or whatever, we'd take that, but we'd get our own title. We'd get it through our insurance, through our law firm that was representing us. And what we would do with them is, we don't pay you and you guys keep the commissions on the title policy. Commissions on title policies are huge. So there are state stipulated rates, and the commissions are as high as 70-80% on these things. So just beware that whoever's providing the title policy is paying a huge commission. So just be aware of that, okay? You can negotiate the commission. Another way to do that is you tell the law firm, listen, we'll let you make so much on it. You know, so there's a lot of different ways to, you know, to skin that cat. Okay? I'm going to back up. I'll show you this, and then we'll kind of go through some of the... So this is the First American form, okay? This is a series that was an industrial complex that we purchased in Jacksonville, okay? And so you can see two different things. You can see a buyer's closing statement, and you can see a seller's closing statement, or you can see a combined statement. In this particular case, I showed you a combined statement which has both the buyer and the seller. Now, these are not debits and credits in accounting terms, okay? So we talk about there's basically four captions, okay, in a closing. So we've got a buyer, and a buyer is going to have a charge, and he's going to have credits. And a seller is going to have charges, and he's going to have credits. Okay? So these are not debits and credits in the traditional accounting sense. These are specific classifications. I'm going to come back and fill some of these in so you get a sense of what these look like. But I just want to show you what a true commercial settlement statement includes, right? So it, like all documents, has a heading, right? So it tells you who's doing it, where they're at, what it is. It gives you a time, it gives you a date, and it gives you a, why does it give you that?
Because of what you said before about the proration of the potential rights and stuff.
No, because we don't prorate down to the hours.
Okay.
Why does it do this? Because this is in flux, and until a closing happens, a closing hasn't happened. You may see 7 versions of this in a day, okay? Because it gets circulated to all the parties, and all somebody says, wait, I forgot, we got this other invoice. Or all somebody says, oh, wait, you didn't include the deposit we sent. Or, oh, wait a minute, this proration's wrong, okay? So
basically edits all day long.
So you got to know which version you're all working on, because now we're all working sort of virtually now. Now we're not in an office. Now stuff is getting circulated, okay?
So that's basically just to identify what version everybody wants.
Basically, yes. Property. What properties are being covered? What is it being funded, okay? Who's the buyer? What's their address? Who's the seller? So this was done as part of a 1031. So we went to a qualified intermediary. That's why you see First American Exchange Company as an intermediary for Flagler Development Group of Jacksonville, okay? So who's the buyer, who's the seller? What's the property, what's the day, and what's being closed? What's the time? Now, from there on, I'm gonna jump all the way down to the bottom. Ultimately, what we wanna get to is a net cash due from or to seller. In order to close, and you typically are going to wind up with some money due from the buyer and some money due to the seller. That would be a normal transaction, right? That assuming the seller has some equity in the deal, you are typically going to see some money coming from the buyer to finish paying everything, and some money going out to the seller. Now, that doesn't always have to be the case, right? You may be upside down on a mortgage. You may owe more than what the property's worth, and so as a seller, you may need to put money into a deal, right? You may have overfunded with deposits to make sure the deal gets done, and as a buyer, you may get a refund at closing, okay? You should, as a buyer and as a seller and attorneys, always have a strive for a minimal amount due to or from the buyer at closing, because the buyer, you should have already had estimates, you should have already wired enough money or have enough financing in place at closing in order to get that closing done. And again, if you have equity as a seller, you should be getting money out. Yes, Claudius.
There's a $3 million gap there. When does that get settled?
What $3 million gap?
Between the buyer and the seller.
Where? What are you talking about? What are you talking about, Willis?
The left side is 75, the right side is 72.
So it doesn't matter. This isn't debits and credits. This isn't accounting. So that's what I want to get to now. Buyer's charges and credits need to equal. Seller's charges and credits need to equal. But they don't need to equal between the two. Because the flows of cash between one party and the other are not identical. So if we were trying to do accounting, debits should equal credits. But these aren't debits and credits. As a buyer, I have a series of transactions. So for example, as a buyer, I may need to be paying for title, I may be paying for a survey, I may be paying my attorney's fees, I may be paying certain expenses that the seller has nothing to do with. So my footings are not going to be the same footings as the buyer. I'm sorry, as the seller. The seller, by the same token, has different transactions. He may need to pay off a mortgage. He may need to pay off a brokerage commission, right? Which I have nothing to do with. Okay, so the footings don't have to equal, but the charges and credits for each party need to equal. Okay? Does that make sense? So that's a very good question. Because ultimately, I was going to work my way down to here, which is, so, because ultimately, if you kind of want to look at it, it's sort of a sources and uses of fund statement, okay? Right, so what are my sources, what are my credits, what are my uses, what did I spend it on, right? So what benefits, you know, am I enduring, right? And what, and how am I funding it, all right? Yes, Mariseva.
This type of transaction, I imagine that you don't ask for like a proof of funds or anything because you're supposed to like $72 million is supposed that you're supposed to buy and it has to be.
Well, so this is being done in escrow. This is an escrow settlement. So you're no longer worried about a proof of funds. Funds need to be somewhere. Okay? Funds. So in a commercial transaction, it may be common as part of an interview of a buyer to find out what his source of funds are, so that you know he can close. But once you're now at this closing, you better not be trying to find money. Okay? By the time you get here, notice that there's a $70 million transaction and the buyer only has to pay $55,000. So I honestly don't remember very much about this transaction. So bless you. There may have been some financing that we assumed, okay? I don't think so, but there may have been some financing that was assumed. We may have gotten some financing for this. I'm getting old. I really don't remember.
I see a lot of due diligence now some money because mainly the source, because of federal regulations, wanting to know also for all that watching stuff, if where the funds are coming from and to show some sort of POF proof of fund.
Okay, so when we do diligence as private individuals, we're doing that for our protection. There's a series of laws that we have to comply with, which may be diligence type items that the government is doing for the protection of the the thing we talked about here the other day, that the government now wants disclosure on the ultimate ownership of a shell company that purchases a residence or any real estate in cash. That's over a million, but that's something that the government wants to know, and we may have to disclose, and there may be things that we need to disclose at closing, but that's not diligence that we're doing for, if I'm selling a property, I don't have a legal obligation that I'm aware of. I could be wrong. I don't think I have a legal obligation under any law in this country to identify what the source of funds are. A bank may have an obligation when it takes a deposit from somebody. I'm not an expert in bank secrecy laws or the Bank Secrecy Act or the Patriot Act, but there are financial intermediaries that have obligations to investigate or identify or report transactions that ultimately lead to know what the source of funds are. But if I'm a seller of a warehouse, I don't need to know where you got the money from. I don't need to know.
As long as it's good money.
I may want to ask as part of my diligence that I know you could get to money. Now I'm buying from a Colombian guy that like has like a bunch of suitcases and stuff, you know. Maybe I don't even want to ask, okay? So there's a difference between legal compliance and due diligence. So in this particular case, we did in fact assume a $35 million life insurance loan, life insurance term loan, okay? So that's a source of funds, right? A credit, all right? Now, what are typical items? What are typical things that you might see? This is a pretty sort of comprehensive one. So what are typical things that you might see? This is important, but rather than just writing down the notes, think about this, right? If I'm a buyer, the purchase price is what to me? Is it a charge or a credit?
If you're the buyer,
it's a charge, right? So remember, if you want to think about it, uses, sources, who's benefiting, how am I funding, right? So the buyer is going to have the selling price If you're a seller, what do you think the selling price is going to be?
Credit.
It's a credit. Right? Now, in this particular case, it's backwards, and I don't know if it's,
no, it's
here.
Correct.
No. That's not, no. That was what I'm going to jump. So, typically, a commission is paid by who in a commercial sales transaction? No, it's not. It's paid to the broker.
The buyer.
Typically by the seller. By the seller. Now, in this particular case, what happened is this was not on the market, and we used to broker the new institutional sellers to identify this property, and we agreed to pay them a commission. But typically in commercial sales transactions, the sales commission is a charge to the seller. And typically, the buyer doesn't get involved in that. Typically. Now,
except for when the buyer asks you to use their broker, which charges them.
So, no. Listen, if you go with an intermediary and identify a property and say, hey, identify that and make an offer, buy it, the seller's never going to pay the commission. And if he does, that's shady.
So what did you put it on that?
That's shady.
But who, I mean, the buyer has a broker that represents him.
Right.
The seller's paying for it.
In institutional transactions, buyers are never represented by brokers. Why? Because you've got acquisitions people that know what they're doing. And they know everybody out there. And so in most, 99% of institutional commercial real estate sales, you do not have buyers represented by brokers. Okay? You never see two brokers in a deal. You're talking about leasing commissions, or you're talking about residential sales, but not institutional commercial real estate sales. Okay? So typically, I explained to you, there are exceptions. This particular building was an exception. Okay? There's a guy named Danny. Danny, who had at HFF, who had a relationship with these people out in Texas, that identified this for us, and we said, okay, we'll pay the commission.
So it doesn't even show it here, it's show on whoever.
No. We have to pay it. It's further down. You'll see it.
It says the HFF.
Right there.
Well,
you see? It. Commission paid to HFF, and since we had to pay it, instead of being a charge there, it was a charge to us. Okay? Yes, sir.
Now, was Danny a licensed broker or not a licensed broker? Or just somebody that wanted to get a commission?
No. Listen.
I know this on purpose.
Listen, we don't. Well, he's not in this class. He's in the class coming up. No, listen. We do things above the law here. No, of course. And Danny works for HFF. He's a broker at HFF.
But could he not be a broker?
Legally, at least in the state of Florida, you cannot pay a commission to someone who is not a licensed broker. So, could we pay a finder's fee? Could we pay a consulting fee? The answer to that is all yes, you can. Okay, but we could not have paid a commission. But not because of a closing, but just because of law, governing law. Okay? So, that's where you see it. Okay, now, let's go through some of the other sort of comments. So, typically, to pay for a transaction, what does a buyer typically bring to the transaction? If there's no financing, what do they bring?
Cash.
So any sort of deposits or cash made by the buyer are usually credits to them, right? So any deposits or any financing that they bring to the table, right, is going to be a credit to the buyer. Make sense? So, in a very simple transaction, I buy this for 100 and I put 100 of cash in the deal. Full stop, right? In a very simple deal, there's no mortgage there, there's 100 credit, cash due to seller at closing, 100.
Who applies commission?
There'll be all other factors being equal. from the broker in the room, of course. Ceteris paribus, all other factors being equal, okay? All right. Okay, you get your commission.
I'm an analyst now. I'm not a broker anymore. I'm out of the brokerage firm.
Okay, yeah, but if you're still wearing a hat, I can see that. Okay, but Claudius, so I'm going to give you a case study. You guys are going to, like, love this because you're going to absorb this. And I'm going to grade it, not like the one I graded last week. Everybody got 100.
On what did we get?
On the lease abstract. Everybody got 100.
Thank you.
But this week.
The numbers don't add.
This week, baby. I bought a new red pen, baby. I bought three of them. Okay, so listen, I just want to walk through some common things. Okay, so there, I've shown you there's certain transactions that may impact both, right? But there may be transactions that only impact the seller or only impact the buyer. Some other ones that may impact both that are common in commercial transactions.
That's
prorations. We're not there yet. We're not there yet. A lot of times we've got deposits that tenants leave. And so you don't want to be cumbersome. So you don't want a seller to reimburse the tenants and then try to get the money from the tenants. So you basically just credit each other. So if you are a buyer and you're receiving or assuming some deposits, you think that's a charge or a credit?
Credit.
You're getting that?
Because I'm assuming a liability. I'm assuming a liability that the buyer, that the seller had. So, deposits assumed. And if you're the seller, that's going to be a?
Charge,
because that's a liability that's been discharged.
So what's it called, deposits discharged?
Well, they're just deposits. So deposits, tenant deposits, are charges because it's a liability. Okay, let's go to another one that only affects the seller. If the seller has a mortgage on the property, what's going to happen at closing? It's going to be paid off, right? So, is it going to be paid to the seller to then pay it off?
No.
Or it's going to be paid at closing, right? By the escrow agent, right? So, what do you think is going to happen with an existing mortgage on a property? It's going to be a charge or a credit?
A charge.
It's going to be a charge to the seller. So, any mortgage satisfied?
Is it the same for an assumption?
Well, so this is a situation where we assume the mortgage, and so what would happen there is, right? So what would happen there is, okay? So it's a source of funds, it's a credit to the buyer, and it's a charge to the seller. Okay? So it may appear, if it's a mortgage just being assumed, it's only going to appear on the seller's side as a charge. If it's a mortgage being assumed, it's going to be a credit to the buyer because he is assuming an obligation. So that's the same thing as having to put cash in, and it's a charge to the seller because it's an obligation that's being discharged, okay? It's cash that he would have to have paid out.
So you said a charge for the buyer if it's assumed, right?
That's correct.
Okay.
All right? Now, I'm only going to cover two major ones, but they can apply to all of them. So we can prorate two things. Rents, if we cut off. So in this country, typically rents are paid when?
At the end of the month.
Beginning of the month.
In this country, rents are typically paid, let's try door number two. Rents are typically paid
in
advance. In advance. In this country, mortgages are typically paid when?
Started
in arrears. Rents are paid in advance. Now, I'm not saying you can contractually have it otherwise, but in this country, mortgages are typically paid in arrears, but rents are paid in advance. And so, let's talk about rents for a second. So what would happen is a seller would bill or would drop a bill to a tenant on the first of a month and collect all the rent, right? But that rent covers the entire month. So if I sell a building on the 15th, I should only be entitled to half of it, okay? And a buyer's gonna say, hey, I want the other half that you collected. So we're gonna prorate based on a number of days, right? So at the end of the day,
let me do what he dreamed.
That's negotiable, right?
That's not typically, I mean, listen. Yeah, it's negotiable, but the only way you're gonna get away pragmatically from prorating rents is to close at the end of the month. Okay, because nobody's gonna give you that. I mean, I've never seen that. Okay.
I wouldn't give it. Wait, so much? No, I wouldn't do it.
Okay. And then you've got operating expenses. So there may be certain expenses that have been paid. I've paid property taxes through the end of the year. So now you get into common practices. In some states, you pay property taxes in advance. In others, you pay them in arrears, right? I'm sorry?
Isn't Florida in arrears?
So in Florida, you actually pay in arrears, right? And so what happens is you pay in arrears based on value at the first day of the year. So it's the value on January 1, but the assessment is made at the end of the year, right? So it's paid, you actually have until February of the subsequent year to pay it. And so what happens is here you've got the other situation in which a seller is not paying for something that they've received the benefit of, and a buyer's gonna have to pay for something that they didn't receive the benefit of, okay? So in that case, what do we think we're going to have with property taxes? Okay, let's. So here we've got this. That is a property tax bill here, right? There were several buildings. Okay, so we've got. Let me make sure. Sometimes I get. Got to think of these things. Got to stop and think. So. Right, so it's no different. Right, it's no different than the deposits, right? Yeah. I'm assuming an obligation on behalf of the seller, so I am going to get a credit for property taxes, right? For the property taxes that were consumed, or the number of days that were consumed by the seller, and he's going to get a charge for the same amount. Okay, now. There's an issue that can get involved in that. I don't want to complicate matters, but the question becomes, a seller's going to say, hey, yeah, but I want to do it based on last year's, you know, rates, because I don't know what the rates are going to be this year, and I want to do it on last year's value because I'm not going to pay the huge increase and bump. And so that becomes a negotiating point. Typically, you just wind up doing it on last year, and the buyer just has to eat the, you know, sort of, he assumes the risk of what increase there may be at the end of the year.
No homestead issues.
Not in commercial.
Can the buyer send a bill to the seller at the end of the year when he gets
so
the
you can, you pay. Can, yeah. You can, in certain cases and with certain transactions, take expenses. You can definitely, you can set up a reserve and climb to it. You can have a period of time in which you can resettle. So I've seen all of that. Again, you tend to see real estate closings are pretty hard, okay? You don't tend to see money held in escrow to cover differences. You don't tend to see periods in which buyers and sellers can credit one another. But can you negotiate it? Yeah, and have I seen them? Yes, okay? Now, I'm sort of curiously here, operating expenses fall into an area in which some expenses may be paid in advance and some may be paid in arrears. Go.
Oh, it's a bunch of taxes. You know, you can do a early payment November and get a discount, it's 4%.
Right.
So in the situation with the escrow agent, you pay it straight to the municipality.
Well, I mean, this, I don't know when this was happening, right?
Well, in that scenario, though, if we were,
so you're saying,
on November,
so. I guess you, probably not. I mean, in a situation like this, you've got a mortgage holder who's probably going to either, so let's go back. So you've got a mortgage holder. So you get, here's a whole other negotiation issue. I got a mortgage on a property. What's the lender gonna typically want? They're gonna want you to give them deposits so that they pay the taxes. If you're an owner, what are you gonna tell a mortgage company? I'm not gonna escrow money with you. I'm gonna pay it when I want to. So in this real life situation, and again, I don't remember, you may have had to go through the mortgage company to pay, number one. Number two, I would doubt that the escrow agent would just pay it there unless they were in arrears. And there were tax assessments in arrear that were essentially encumbrances on the property, I would see them being paid at escrow. Otherwise, I guess you can agree to it, but I don't recall ever having seen that. I don't see why you can't agree to do it. So operating expenses, the easiest thing to do with operating expenses is to terminate all contracts the day of closing, reset all meters the day of closing, and so there's no proration. That's the ideal thing. So the ideal thing is you call FP&L, you call the Water and Sewer Authority, and they come and they meter that day, and they send a previous guy an invoice, and then you start getting an invoice going forward.
Is there a risk that the price could be greater?
No, because most of that stuff is regulated. So, as it relates to utilities.
Okay.
To the extent you've got other operating expenses where you've got
maintenance,
third-party providers, yeah. Ideally you've negotiated a new contract with them. And so they're going to bill the previous owner through that day, and they're going to bill you going forward. Does it always work like that? No. And here you've got a situation where you actually had some expenses that were being paid in advance and some that were being paid in arrears, and there were estimates. So you actually had charges and credits going back and forth, okay? So, depending on the timing of the payment, it may be a charge or a credit to the buyer, right? So if a seller has paid an entire month and is only getting part of the credit or benefit, he's going to get a credit at closing, right? And there's going to be a charge to the buyer, right? If it's the other way around, like the taxes, right? That the seller is going to reap the benefits, but the buyer is going to pay. You're going to see a credit to the buyer and a charge to the seller. Okay? Did you have a question? Question? Yes.
Accounting standpoint, if this was a new building, wouldn't the taxes be assessed in the rear and it'd be artificially low?
Well, so
when it was CO'd.
So let's go back. Property taxes drop or assessments drop at the same time, regardless of what's happening on site. The value in Florida is determined the first day of the year. So whatever the condition of the building was the first of the year is what that assessment's going to be based on. So that really has nothing to do with when you buy or sell a building. I mean, this was a stabilized building. That's why there's rent and all that. So it wasn't just, newly constructed. Now, assuming this was a newly constructed building, it may have an assessment based on just land value. And at the end of the year, or really the subsequent year, is going to be already with all the improvements. It's going to be a radically different situation. And that's where you get into, you might be able to work something out with the buyer and the seller to prorate it based on some sort of estimate, or to be able to claw back, or be able to readjust with the seller or use an estimate. But likely not. Likely you're either going to agree on a value or you're just going to prorate based on the previous years. Okay, make sense? So, along those are sort of, basic ones, right? Along those lines, there's a series of transactions that may not impact other people. We had attorneys that represented us. We had to pay them. That's a charge to us. They had attorneys that represented them. That's a charge to them, okay? And then you go back, everybody. So why is there a closing? Why is there a closing? Why is there a closing?
To convey titles.
Well, that's one of the things that can happen. I would say pragmatically, it's the one time and place where all the money comes into one bucket. Yes. And more importantly, everybody that needs to get paid can get paid at that time. So it's the one time where it all comes together and it all goes out. And because there's money there, what do you think happens to service providers at the time of closing? They want to get paid. Well, but they want to get paid. So, for example, we could pay our attorneys separately. We don't have to pay them at closing, but they want to get paid. Let's get paid at closing. The seller's attorney could get paid afterwards. Let's get paid now. All the guys that make photocopies, the surveyors, all kinds of people are sending bills in because we know there's money at closing. And so to make sure that there's no leftover, you also then tend to see all kinds of junk down here, right? You know, a title search, a courier, you know, and everybody, you know, little fees for 30, it costs more to put the $30 here than to actually, you know, get it, right? Title policy, right? Endorsements. Dock stamps, okay? Recording fees. Yes, ma'am.
Don't you identify like whatever has been paid already, like for example, survey, it's already been paid, even though you put it there, like it's expense of, I mean, would they don't identify
So, I mean, you've got to take a look at the situation. Let's take a look at pre-sale. I paid for a survey and I'm gonna let you have it. And I have to pay nothing more. Well, that wouldn't appear here. I agreed to engage a surveyor to update a survey, you know, for you, and I gotta pay $1,500. That surveyor is gonna send his invoice here to make sure he gets paid here.
So whatever is being has been paid in advance, they don't put it here? I mean, it's not recorded as part?
Well, like, give me another example.
Appraisals and stuff like that.
Whose appraisal? For what benefit?
Well, like the buyer, you know, for finance, you know?
Okay, but so there's going to be a mortgage coming online, right? The bank's going to have attorneys. They're going to want to make sure that there's an appraisal that's been done for the bank, not in advance, for the bank, for this amount that's being financed. That appraisal is going to be paid at closing. That won't be paid in advance.
Because I only think because of my residential, we pay a lot of stuff in advance, like appraisal. They pay like a credit card, they charge, and that's it. So I just wasn't sure if you add those posts there and just put it as, I don't know, identify them.
You probably wouldn't put something like that. I paid a courier to run all this stuff, but I already paid him. It's not going to appear here. The law firms used a common courier service, and he ran up $3,000 worth of charges. It hasn't been paid. He's going to get paid here. Okay. Yes, Rebecca.
So, like, the check at the end, does that get dispersed among, like, all the people that have been involved?
Well, so, in this particular case, for example, the escrow agent's going to wire money to HFF, to Ackerman, right? To Winstead, to Skadden Arps, to Holland and Knight, okay? They're gonna send this to the mortgage company. They're gonna hold on to all these fees that they incurred. They're gonna pay this to the clerk of the county court or the tax collector. They're gonna send all these additional deposits that we needed. They're going to send to the insurance company, etc. Yes, sir.
So on the dock stamps, let's see, it says estimate. I mean, if they're going to wire it directly at closing, do they true up the value if it's different afterwards?
Well, so ideally, there's no estimate, and this is not the final one. Okay, so I don't know when I grab this, if I really grab the final one, you probably wouldn't see that. Okay?
But in theory, if it
was, the escrow agent would probably estimate on the high side or would ask you to hold some money there. Okay. Or you'd have a really good relationship with them.
What's the total cost of closing on this deal? Do you have that?
I don't have it. I mean, when you say cost, like what are the expenses?
Yeah, I just want to like...
Listen. Why don't start jotting down. Start adding. Let's go through.
Can we
real? Sorry.
Can you send us a copy of that?
I'm not going to send you this one because this is a proprietary transaction. What I am going to send you is a very similar. So I'm going to tell you what I'm going to send you in a second. Okay? Because you're going to get the same thing you're asking for. Okay. Listen. Whether the buyer or the seller paid for, add this up. 456. 130, 45, 25. Say 50. Just say 50.
Okay.
125. That's it. What's that give you? Because some of them aren't costs. Some are cash flows, but they're not expenses.
They're in the charge. I'll do it in March.
Don't worry about it. Let's do it again because that's it's a good frame of reference. I'm going to tell you it's not going to exceed a point and a half. Okay.
That's what I'm trying to get.
It's not going to exceed that.
Yeah, yeah.
And the larger a transaction, the lower.
I
would say a point and a half, but on a $70 million deal, it's probably less. But do it here. I'll do it.
I got it. I did it wrong.
Okay, go. 456. Call this 200. Call this 50. And call this 125.
831. Yeah, 831,000.
Divided by 72 million.
Yeah.
1.15.
Yeah.
It's not going to exceed a point and a half. Guys, hold on. Guys, hold on a second. Relax.
My head hurts up so hungry, so I'm not.
So does mine.
Sorry.
Just relax. We're almost done.
What happened if you get to closing and there's no closing for whatever reason? Who paid for all this stuff, like survey fees?
Well, whoever contracted it.
Okay, so because I know the title company, that's what I'm like, I just want to see. So
title company doesn't usually contract this, and if they do, they contract it on behalf of somebody.
And somebody has to sign it, okay.
So, yeah, again, look, if we get here, there's going to be a closing, okay? There's too much money invested, okay? Now, Claudius left, and I was going to answer his question. So here's what we're going to do. Claudius, here's what we're going to do. So we're going to do a case study. By the way, I used to cover a little bit about title, but I know that you guys cover title in your finance class or in your investments class? Which
legal.
One? Or legal. Okay, so I'm not going to spend any time on that. It's not my strong suit anyway. It's like, okay, go to the attorney and let them tell you this. Claudius, here's what you guys are going to get. At the same time we did this, we purchased 4 office buildings in Orlando. In the Maitland submarket, about $40 million, and so I've taken that real life scenario and I've dumped it down a little bit, so I don't have all of these transactions, but I'm going to send you a case with a series of things that happened in real life in 2008, and I'm going to send you a template of a combined buyers and sellers closing statement, okay? And what you're going to be charged with doing is coming up with that closing statement.
That's our final case study?
I think so. We only have one more session.
I understand.
I think so.
Yeah, I
I never know.
Wait, is it done in class or?
No, that's okay.
It's assumed it is.
What documentation are we going to be provided to know?
Right.
Who's paying for what and what those fees are?
Right.
Read the case study. You will know. Will you know if you follow?
Yes, you will know.
You will know if you follow the case study. If you follow the instructions of the case study that says that if you read it and then segregate the things that logically belong to the buyer, things that logically belong to the seller, things that were agreed to be paid by the buyer, things that were agreed to be paid by the seller, things that were agreed to be prorated, right? So start creating your buckets. Then you take your template and you start putting forms. And I want to tell you this, because I never tell the classes this. If your charges don't even equal your credits, you're FUBAR. Sorry?
FUBAR?
Yeah, I don't want to tell you. You don't want to know what that is. So, credits have to equal charges, okay? Buyer's credits and charges don't have to equal the seller's credits and charges, okay? So, and there has to be something logical in it. So it's a similar situation, but it's not an identical situation, okay? All right, now, I'm gonna tell you this.
Is this a group?
No, absolutely not. So I'm gonna tell you this. I still remember, because I have my notes on this. I wrote the case study, and then I had to come up with an answer. Those of you who have had my class before, if I were to get answers that have no backup, if I were to see spreadsheets that have hard coding, you will be marked down for it.
What do you mean hard coding?
Well, yeah, we'll type in
formulas for everything.
Formulas that reference back to source numbers.
Okay, yeah. So like, if it says 1,200 a month, don't just put in
1,200. Or don't just put in 14,400. You have a cell that says 12 months. You have a cell that says 1,200 per month. And then in your cell you say, you know, equals this times that, or plus this times that. Oh, because that's like a mortal sin. You don't hard code, because what if you have to make a change?
Change a number, it changes the whole spreadsheet. It's pretty cool once you do it.
So basically, he wants to make sure.
And if you have to do calculations, I want to see calculations. Because if I don't know where your number came from, I can't give you partial credit.
But when you say sources,
you have the hard code.
You have source numbers and you have calculations. Source numbers are assumptions that you use that can be changed.
I call it a data tag. The word that shows it basically a raw data sheet. You basically get an extra workbook where you call your numbers and then you reference everything from that.
Okay, now, other things. I've said this before. If I get a spreadsheet that is labeled case study number 4. Whose is it? So, I've asked for this, please. Let's use this naming. Give me last name dot case. I don't care what you call the case, but put your name on it. I mean, I got all these things the other day. I got leaseabstract.xls. And unfortunately, because I was saving them fast, then I went to grade them and I'm like, thank God you all got hundreds. Because then I'm like, no, I had to go back to the emails to go. Okay, who labeled this leaseabstract, you know? Put your name on it. Okay, what was your question? You got a question, Ben.
Yeah, so you said you wanted references to the source data. What you want, like a comment inside of each cell
four? No, look, I'm going to give you an example of what I'm talking about, what you just said, right?
I mean, so I understand the formulas and that.
Let's just do, what do you want, Victor? Am I going to send you what?
An example?
You want you to send this example to him?
Yeah. We need an example plus a template.
Because that's what
if you want the suggested answers too.
You can do that too if you want.
If you want to.
No, honestly, for me, for the least abstract, I don't know how in detail you wanted the
You got 100, bro.
The stuff.
You got 100.
No, I'm just saying.
Listen, so we all have. I'm not gonna. I know Claudius is a college professor, and so he's, you know, he's got a good base of reference as to how to teach and how people learn. But I've got mine as well, and with financial concepts. Look, I'm not going to send you something to do by rote. I want ingenuity. I want creativity. Because at the end of the day, a spreadsheet is what you make of it.
Right.
But there's certain rules of the road, of etiquette, that make it easy for someone to review, for you to make changes. So I'm going to show you an example. Number of months. Rent per month, right? I'm going to give you a better one. Rent per square foot. Okay? So, per, right? So let's say number of square feet. Okay, I spelled that right, yeah?
You want to standardize it here.
Okay? Right. So let's say that there are 12 months in a year. Let's say they're going to charge $1.18 a square foot. And let's say that there are 800 square feet in a unit. Okay, let's say that we're going to build 23 units, right? So we could, number of units. Whatever, okay, you know, okay. So let's say we're going to do 23 units. So we could say that our revenue is, for example, we could go that.
You could do equal, whatever.
I just do plus and then, or minus, okay?
Yeah, well, you couldn't do
so
that.
You could do that. Now, listen.